It gives me a great pleasure to be here this evening. When my friend Abigail called me to invite me to this panel, to join this panel, he said that I would like to warn you that other Palestinians who have initially accepted have withdrawn because of the fact that Hodgkins has withdrawn, has boycotted the conference, and so many Palestinians have felt that they should not be part of this because of that also. My answer was that he said, that's why you need to know that. I said, I already know that. My answer was that we, in our conflict, actually, it's a different conflict than what happened with Gandhi in India, or with Mandela in South Africa, or with Martin Luther King in the United States. This is a conflict in which we need dialogue, and we don't need boycott. It's a conflict that we need. It's a conflict in which we need to talk to each other and explain to each other. Actually, this will give us more trust, more security than if we boycott. So the idea is to build bridges and not walls. Walls actually separates us. Bridges brings us together. Actually, in times of, I believe that in times of conflict, being moderate is revolutionary. So basically, we were asked as a panelist actually to answer the question that in the coming years, will political Islam prove that it is capable of shaping a new Middle East, one with stability, democracy, economic prosperity, human rights, and equality for women? Or will it fail to live up to its expectations and drag the region further into violence, tyranny, and economic decline? Actually, I believe that here, we are talking about what do we mean by political Islam and which political Islam. So actually if you look at the causes of the Arab Spring, we find that there has been attributed many issues to why did the Arab Spring did take place. And most of these were related to secular issues, to, and for instance, lack of democracy, lack of transparency, no accountability, different reasons. However, these reasons would have brought in a secular power on front, like what happened in the French Revolution or the Russian Revolution. However, it brought to power Islamist religious elite. The question is why did an Islamist elite come in, and how will that affect our future? I believe that basically it has to do with Samuel Huntington's thesis of the clash of civilization, in which that thesis actually that there is a clash between the two cultures of Islam versus Judaism and Christianity. And so it created a lot of anxiety, insecurity, fear, distrust among the masses of Muslims. So when the Islamists came, they reaped the Arab Spring, making it an Islamic Spring. And as a result, they reaped it. Why? Basically, because the power of democracy has moved from the urban areas, where there is secular power, to the rural areas, where actually people there are not educated, are more ignorant. And so when these people voted, whether in Palestine or in Egypt or in other areas, they did not vote for the political party, which actually either the Muslim Brotherhood or Hamas or others, they voted for Islam. They felt that Islam is under threat, and the West is against it. And so as a result, whoever held the banner of Islam was voted in. So basically, an organization like Hamas, which was totally unknown in Palestine, or the Muslim Brotherhood, which was not popular in Egypt, got elected because they carried the banner of Islam. And so many of them would say, I have seen banners in Palestine that would say, vote for Islam, vote for Hamas, and heaven will be your reward. So basically, the association of electing Islamists to power has been a vote for Islam rather than a vote for the party or for the movement. The question is, what does this mean? What is the future? Now the answer would be is to look what type of Islam do we have. What does Hamas teach the children? What does the Muslim Brotherhood teach the children? Do they teach it that Islam calls for freedom of religion, for tolerance, for existence, for human rights, for women rights? Or do they teach them that on the opposite, that Islam is the best among other religions? The Judaism and Christianity have been lost. And for instance, if you take the Fatiha, when they say that in the Fatiha, when it says in the Quran that guide us to the right of those whom you have blessed, not of those with whom you are angry or with those who are lost. So are they teaching them that those who are blessed are the pious, or are they teaching them that those who are blessed are the Muslims, and then those who are, God is angry with the Jews, or God is angry with the people who do not believe in him, or those who are lost, as they are teaching it, are the Christians, rather than saying are the hypocrites. So what kind of Islam is being taught to the children? Is it being taught that Islam is separate from the other religions, or is it part of the other messages that has been before it? Does it teach them that we should allow freedom of religion, or we shouldn't? So basically, I believe that in the Muslim community is moderate, and now that who are in power are the radicals, because they are reaping the revolutions that took place. I hope that, like what happened in Iran, that there will be the democracy will elect moderate Islam, and if such, then we will have democracy. And we will have equality, and we will have tolerance and coexistence. However, if the other type of Islam is being will try to they use the ladder of democracy to reach power, the question is, will they allow the opposition to use it again, or will they burn that ladder in order to remain in power? Thank you.
Thank you.